Hello everyone, welcome to Achievers IAS classes. Let's begin our discussion on the current events of 27th January 2018. The Hindu Today has various articles on different sectors of cooperation between India and ASEAN, as well as an editorial on the relationship between India and the ASEAN community. I'll club all these together and we'll try to see the relevant points from the examination point of view. As we all know, all the leaders from the ASEAN community supported a more proactive role for India in the Asia-Pacific region to uphold peace, stability and prosperity, indicating the growing concerns over China's continued build-up in the South China Sea. Apart from the maritime cooperation between the countries of the region, they also discussed and agreed upon for a swift conclusion of the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. In specific discussions with countries like Malaysia and Indonesia, we also discussed cooperation in the field of counterterrorism. Miscellaneous topics like India-ASEAN, space cooperation, support to the micro, small and medium enterprises to integrate them into the global value chains also came up in the discussions. The visiting dignitaries who were the guest of honor at the Republic Day Parade also witnessed India's indigenous capabilities like the Nirbhay missile, the light helicopter Rudra, the BrahMos missile systems, and several countries have expressed interest in buying these systems. This renewed emphasis on relations between the India and ASEAN community underlines the new need for consensus between the two for several reasons, like firstly, the demand for goods in the Western economies are coming down, and both India and ASEAN have the need to look for newer markets to increase their trade. Secondly, continuing tensions between great powers in the region, like between US and Russia or between US and China, are forcing the unaligned countries of ASEAN to forge a common understanding with India. Thirdly, India and ASEAN share cultural and trade ties which go back to 2000 years, thereby offering a unique opportunity to reap the potential of their geographical proximity. Therefore, the Delhi Declaration which they signed recently has looked into several of these aspects to deepen security, economic and socio-cultural cooperation in South and Southeast Asia. However, such commitments are not new, but a similar declaration was passed in the year 2012, but several promises related to trade and maritime security are yet to be realized. Also, India's trade with ASEAN stands much lower than not just bigger countries like the United States and China, but also smaller countries like South Korea, Japan and Australia. The Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, which was launched in the year 2012, has been held up majorly due to India's concern over access to Chinese goods and ASEAN resistance to the movement of Indian services, which they feel can hurt their domestic industry. Adding to all this, connectivity in South and Southeast Asia is considered to be the poorest, and various infrastructure projects like the India-Myanmar-Thailand Trilateral Highway have failed to meet the deadlines. In this regard, there has to be greater investment in the border trade posts and developing infrastructure in the Northeast to better integrate with the ASEAN region. And both India and ASEAN countries have to put in much effort to reap the potential of the region and the increased ties between the countries. With that, let's move on to the next issue in news, which is regarding one of the major concerns of the government, that is the huge burden of bank loans in the banking sector. The Reserve Bank of India in the year 2015 had begun a major asset quality review following allegations that banks were hiding the extent of bad debts, thereby projecting a false picture of their financial health. The central bank in this regard has ordered for initiation of bankruptcy proceedings against big corporate defaulters, and the Union government too has introduced a reforms package including the bank recapitalization program of various public sector banks. The increase in bad and stressed loans was basically due to the prolonged economic slowdown, which decreased the company's ability to repay its debt. Also, lack of due diligence by the financial institutions was responsible for the fall in asset quality of these banks. In this regard, the tighter rules and the new bankruptcy code introduced have finally begun to show results, according to reports by a private news agency. which says that the quantum of stressed loans has fallen by 0.4% than what it was earlier. With that, let's move on to the next issue in news, which is an editorial on the rising prices of fuel and its consequences on the Indian economy. The international crude oil prices have been rising sharply in the last few months, which is influenced mainly by the decisions of major oil producers like the OPEC members. India had benefited by the decline in oil prices, mainly due to the shale oil boom from the United States, as well as the supply glut in the market due to excessive production by various countries. But the recent spurt in prices seems to be more due to the weakening of US dollar rather than any other factors. The rise in fuel prices will directly impact the consumers in India because the government has adopted the policy of dynamic daily pricing of petrol and diesel. In order to reduce the increasing pressure of oil prices on domestic consumers, there is no need for the government to subsidize fuel, but the government has to rationalize taxes on petrol and diesel to bring down the retail prices of these goods. In the long term, the government has to incentivize domestic exploration of hydrocarbons by tweaking the hydrocarbon exploration and licensing policy to encourage self-reliance, which is particularly important given the huge dependence of India on imports for its crude oil requirements. With that, I wrap up today's news analysis. Do like, share, and comment to support this initiative. Thank you for watching. Have a nice day.